So last time we have studied the rectum and anal canal. So we have finished the small intestine and the large intestine. So what are the differences between this small and the large intestine? In the small intestine, there is the absence of the appendices, epiploci, Tanya coli, circulation and haustration, whereas these structures are present in the large intestine. Appendices, epiploche, Tanya coli, circulations, all they are the characteristic features of the large intestine. Then the distensibility, it is less in the small intestine, whereas more in the large intestine. And greater part of the small intestine, it is mobile, because they are suspended by the mesentery, whereas the greater part of the large intestine, it is fixed. Characteristic features of the small intestine, there is a presence of the villi, whereas villi it is absent in the large intestine. Bulb of Corcoran or the transverse mucosal fold or the circularis mucosa, it is permanent in small intestine, whereas they are absent in case of the large intestine. Pears patches, it is only present in the ileum, which is a distal part of the small intestine, and Pears patches, they are absent in the large intestine. And small intestine, they are the common site for the intestinal worms, typhoid, tuberculosis, whereas the large intestine, they are the common site for the dysentery and the carcinoma. And effects of infection and irritation in the small intestine cause the diarrhea, and in case of the large intestine, it cause the dysentery. So these are the differences between the small and the large intestine. Effects of infections and irritation causes in the small intestine diarrhea, whereas in large intestine, it can cause the dysentery. So these are the differences between the small and the large intestine. So this diagram illustrates how the primitive gourd is formed. All of we know that in the fourth week, there is folding occurs, and foldings via the cephalocaudal as well as the lateral foldings occurs. So as a result of cephalocaudal as well as the lateral folding of the emroi, the endoderm lining of the yolk sac, it is incorporated in the emroi. It is incorporated in the emroi, forming a tubular structure. This tubular structure is called the primitive gourd. So how primitive gourd is formed? So at the fourth week of emroi, as a result of the cephalocaudal folding as well as the lateral folding, the endoderm lined yolk sac is incorporated in the emroi. Endoderm lined yolk sac is incorporated in the emroi, forming the as a result of the cephalocaudal foldings and the lateral foldings, the endoderm lined yolk sac is incorporated in the emroi, forming a tubular structure. This tubular structure is called the primitive gourd. This tubular structure is called primitive gourd. And this primitive gourd, it is connected with the yolk sac via vitelline duct. See, first of all, yolk sac is there. This yolk sac, which is lined by the endoderm, it is incorporated within the emroi, forming a tubular structure. That tubular structure is called the primitive gourd. And this primitive gourd, it is connected with the secondary yolk sac or the yolk sac via vitelline duct or the yolk sac duct. Clear? So how primitive gourd is formed? By the incorporations of the endoderm lined yolk sac within the emroi. And the part of the primitive gourd which is connected with the yolk sac via the Vitelline duct, is called the meat gut. See, the part of the, here this is the primitive gut. Now this primitive gut, it is divided into the three parts from cranial to caudally. They are the foregut, meat gut, and hind gut. Foregut, meat gut, and hind gut. Meat gut, which is connected with the yolk sac via the Vitelline duct. The part of the primitive gut which is connected with the yolk sac via Vitelline duct is called the meat gut. And the part of the primitive gut or the primary gut which is cranial to the meat gut is foregut, and caudal to the meat gut is the hind gut. Foregut, cranially it is continuous with the stomatodium via the buccopharyngeal membrane or the oropharyngeal membrane, and caudally the hind gut is continuous with the proctodium. And the junctions between the hind gut and the proctodium is the cloacal membrane. Junction of the stomatodium and the foregut is the buccopharyngeal membrane. So first of all, primitive gut is formed. Primitive gut tube is formed, and this primitive gut tube, it is divided into the foregut, meat gut, and hind gut. The part of the primitive gut which is connected with the yolk sac via the Vitelline duct is called meat gut. And cranial to meat gut is the foregut, and caudal to the meat gut is the hind gut. Clear? Foregut, it is in continuation cranially with the stomatodium, and hind gut will continue downward as the proctodium. This stomatodium and the proctodium, these are the ectodermal derivatives. Whereas the foregut, meat gut, and the hind gut, these are the endodermal derivatives. And this entire foregut, meat gut, and the hind gut, it gives the derivatives of the gastrointestinal system. Foregut, meat gut, hind gut, it gives the derivatives of the gastrointestinal system. Except the a part of the oral cavity, which is derived from the stomatodium, and a terminal part of the anal canal, it is derived from the proctodium. So their origin, it is from the upper part of the oral cavity. They derive from the ectoderm. And the terminal part of the anal canal, as they derive from the proctodium, it is ectodermal in origin. Except the terminal part of the anal canal and the cranial part of the oral cavity, all parts of the gastrointestinal system, their derivatives, it is from the endoderm. They are endodermal in origin. Clear? So, what are the derivatives of the foregut, meat gut, and the hind gut? At the 4th week old embryo, the ventral wall of the foregut, it gives a diverticulum. This diverticulum is called the long bud or the respiratory diverticulum. And the part of the foregut which lies cranial to the respiratory diverticulum, it forms the pharyngeal gut. And this tracheobronchial diverticulum or the respiratory diverticulum, ventrally it forms the parts of the respiratory system, and dorsal to the respiratory buds, it forms the esophagus. And caudal to the respiratory diverticulum. Caudal to the respiratory diverticulums of the foregut, it appears as a fusiform dilatations. It forms a fusiform dilation to form the stomach. See how pharyngeal gut is formed, esophagus, and stomach. First of all, in the 4th week of embryo, it gives the ventral wall of the foregut forms a diverticulum. This diverticulum is called the respiratory diverticulum. and this respiratory diverticulum divides the foregut, cranial and the caudal. Cranial part forms the pharyngeal gut or the pharynx, and the part which lies caudal to the respiratory diverticulum, it forms the, or it appears as a dilations, fusiform dilations, which gives the, or the which forms the stomach. And behind the respiratory diverticulum, it gives rise the esophagus. And the junction of foregut and the mid gut is the liver gut. Liver gut, which appears in the distal part of the foregut, which is a diverticulum, arise ventral wall of the foregut, ventral wall of the distal foregut. And this liver gut is the demarcations between the foregut and the midgut. So what is the demarcations between the foregut and the midgut? Liver gut is the demarcations between the foregut and midgut. So above the liver gut, they are the foregut, and distal to the liver is the middle midgut. It is a midgut. And midgut and the hindgut, what is the junctions between the midgut and the hindgut? It is the junctions between the midgut and the hindgut are the point at the point between the right 2/3 of the transverse colon and the left 1/3 of the transverse colon. Transverse colon, it is divided into the right 2/3 and the left 1/3 of the transverse colon. So the junctions between the right 2/3 of the transverse colon and the left 1/3 of the transverse columns, the column demarcates the midgut and the hindgut. So what is the junction between the foregut? What is the demarcations for the foregut and the midgut? Liver gut. And what is the demarcations for the midgut and the hindgut? Transverse colon. It is divided into the right 2/3 and the left 1/3. The junctions of the right 2/3 and the left 1/3 demarcates the point between the hindgut and the midgut. So here it is the development of the esophagus. You know, cranial to the respiratory diverticulum, it gives rise to the pharynx. Now, all of we know that we have studied the development of the respiratory system. In the fourth week, from the ventral wall of the foregut, respiratory diverticulum appears, which bifurcates into the two buds. They are named as the long buds, and cranial to the long buds are the trachea. And this trachea and the esophagus are the dorsal part of the foregut. They are divided by the tracheoesophageal septum. Septum, which divides ventrally, is the respiratory system, and dorsal part of the foregut gives rise the esophagus. Dorsal part of the respiratory system, it gives rise the esophagus. So cranial to the esophagus is the pharynx, and caudal to the esophagus is the stomach. So how the stomach develops? For the development of the stomach, the primitive foregut, it appears as a fusiform dilations. Where the stomach has to develop, the foregut appears as a fusiform dilation. Okay, the stomach appears as a fusiform dilation. So it has a ventral anterior border, posterior border, left surface, and the right surface. See, initially the primitive cord tube, they all lie in the midline. They all lie in the midline. But we know that the normal positions of the stomach, it is in the left upper quadrant. That is, the regions are the left hypogastric, left hypochondrium, epigastrium, and a part of the umbilical region. So how this midline fusiform dilations stomach, how they will locate in the normal anatomical position. For that anatomical positions, they have to undergo the rotates along, there will be the rotations of the stomach along its longitudinal axis as well as the anteroposterior axis. Longitudinal axis and the anteroposterior axis. So during the longitudinal axis, it rotates 90 degree clockwise rotations. It undergoes the 90 degree clockwise rotations around the longitudinal axis. Because of that reason, the left surface becomes the anterosuperior surface and the right surface, it becomes the posterior inferior surface. Because of that reason, anterosuperior surface, initially the left surface, it is supplied by the left vagus nerve, and the right surface supplied by the right vagus nerve. As because of the 90 degree clockwise rotations around the longitudinal axis, now this right surface becomes the posterior inferior surface and left surface becomes the anterosuperior surface. Because of that reason, the anterosuperior surface, it is supplied via the left vagus nerve, which forms the posterior trunk, and the posterior inferior surface, they are supplied via the right vagus nerve, forms anterior vagal anterior ventral border, or the anterior border becomes the left border of the stomach. Rotations. At that time, the left surface becomes the anterosuperior surface, and the right surface it becomes the posteroinferior surface, and the ventral border, it forms the lesser curvature, and the dorsal border, it forms the greater curvature. At this time, they all lie in the midline. So via the anteroposterior axis, when the stomach rotates around the anteroposterior axis, the cardiac orifice, it shifts on the left side, and the pyloric orifice, it lies right to the mid plane or the median line. So by the longitudinal rotational axis and the anteroposterior axis, now the stomach lies in the normal anatomical position, that is the left hypochondrium, epigastrium, and a part of the umbilical region. In this diagram, the terminal part of the foregut, it is connected to the posterior wall via the dorsal mesogastrium, and the lesser omentum, it is connected to the ventral wall via the ventral mesogastrium, and ventral mesogastrium, they derive from the septum transversum. Here, the foregut, the terminal part of the foregut, it is connected to the posterior wall via the dorsal mesogastrium, and to the body wall, it is connected via the ventral mesogastrium. And ventral mesogastrium is derived from the septum transversum. As all of you know that the terminal part of the foregut, it gives the long bud, and this lever bud develops within the ventral mesogastrium. So this lever bud divides the ventral mesogastrium into the ventral part of the ventral mesogastrium and the dorsal part of the ventral mesogastrium. Initially, there is a ventral mesogastrium. With ventral mesogastrium, there is the growth of the lever bud, and this lever bud divides the ventral mesogastrium into the ventral part and the dorsal part. So this ventral part of the ventral mesogastrium forms the falciform ligament, which connects the lever to the anterior wall of the body cavity. And the dorsal part of the ventral mesogastrium gives rise to the lesser omentum. And this lesser omentum, it connects the lesser curvature of the stomach to the liver. It's important for the MCQ also as well as for the Viva also. So how ventral mesogastrium is formed? It is derived from the septum transversum. And within the ventral mesogastrium, there is the outgrowth of the lever bud. And this lever bud divides the ventral mesogastrium into the ventral part and the dorsal part. Ventral part forms the falciform ligament, and the dorsal part of the ventral mesogastrium forms the lesser omentum. And here, the dorsal mesogastrium, it forms the greater omentum, which connects the greater curvature of the stomach. See, distal to the lever bud, the midgut and the hindgut, ventrally, there are no ventral mesentery. There is absence of the ventral mesentery, but the posteriorly, it is connected to the posterior abdominal wall via dorsal mesentery. Anteriorly, in the posterior abdominal wall. And from this diagram, it is also clear. See, the derivatives of the foregut, it is supplied by the celiac artery. It is supplied by the branches of the celiac artery or the celiac trunk. And the derivatives of the midgut, they are supplied by the superior mesenteric artery, branches of the superior mesenteric artery. And the derivatives of the hindgut, they are supplied via the branches of the inferior mesenteric artery. This dorsal mesentery, it gives rise to mesentery in case of the derivatives of the midgut, or the in case of the small intestine, it forms the mesentery. And in case of the colon or the large intestine, it forms the mesocolon, like the sigmoid mesocolon, transverse mesocolon, mesoappendix. Now the midgut loop, it extends from the lever bud to the junctions of the right 2/3 of the transverse colon and the left 1/3 of the transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon, rectum, and the part of the anal canal up to the pectinate line. These are the derivatives of the hindgut. And the derivatives of the midgut are second part of the duodenum, distal to the major duodenal papilla, because the liver bud, it gives rise the bile duct and the pancreatic duct, they fuse and forms the hepatopancreatic duct, which opens in the major duodenal papilla. So second part of the duodenum, distal to the major duodenal papilla, third part of the duodenum, fourth part of the duodenum, small jejunum, and the most of the ileum अर्थात इलियम, सिकम, वर्मिफॉर्म अपेंडिक्स, असेंडिंग कोलन एंड द राइट टू थर्ड ऑफ द ट्रांसवर्स कोलन, दे आर द डेरिवेटिव्स ऑफ द मीट गट. They are the derivatives of the meat gut. And this meat gut, it is divided into the cranial limb and the caudal limb via the superior mesenteric artery. This superior mesenteric artery divides the meat gut loop into the pre-arterial segment and the post-arterial segment. See here, this is the major duodenal papilla, And the major duodenal papilla is the junctions of the foregut and the meat gut. So the foregut, derivatives of the foregut are the floor of the mouth, then the pharynx, stomach, esophagus, first part of the duodenum, and the cranial part of the second part of the duodenum up to the major duodenal papilla. These all are the derivatives of the foregut, which is supplied by the celiac trunk. And the meat gut loop, it extends from the major duodenal papilla to the point between the right 2/3 of the transverse colon and the left 1/3 of the transverse colon. Now this meat gut loop, it is divided into the pre-arterial segment and the post-arterial segment by the superior mesenteric artery. See here, it is the superior mesenteric artery. The superior mesenteric artery divides the meat gut loop into the cranial and the caudal part. Cranial part also called as the pre-arterial segment. And the caudal part, or the distal to the part of the meat gut which lies distal to the superior mesenteric artery, is the post-arterial segment of the meat gut or the caudal segment of the meat gut. And this pre-arterial, now you are clear na how the meat gut, it is divided into the pre-arterial segment and the post-arterial segment by the superior mesenteric artery. So during the process of the development, first of all, this pre-arterial segment, it undergoes the elongation. See, first of all, the pre-arterial segment, it undergoes the elongations and starts the coiling, but at the sixth week of the intrauterine life, the abdominal cavity is insufficient to accommodate the elongated intestine. Because of that reason, this intestine, it is herniated outside the abdominal cavity to the umbilical cord. Why it is herniated? Because of the small abdominal cavity and the enlargement of the liver. As well as the small abdominal cavity, for the time being, the intestinal segment, it is herniated outside the abdominal cavity and lodges in the extra embryonic coelom. This process is called as the physiological herniations of the meat gut. Because of this small abdominal cavity, for the time being, it has to herniate outside the abdominal cavity. But by the 10th week of the embryo, now because of the differential growth of the body wall cavity, now there is a sufficient area to accommodate the intestine. Now this intestine from the exocoelomic cavity to intraembryonic cavity, it will enter, and this process will occur by the 10th week of the embryo. It has to return by the 10th week of embryo. If it fails to return, then that condition is called as omphalocele or the exomphalos. By the 10th week of the intrauterine life, embryonic life, the herniated intestine has to enter the abdominal cavity. If it fails to enter, then that condition is called the omphalocele or the exomphalus. Omphalocele or the exomphalus. And during the rotations of the meat gut loops will rotate around the anti-clockwise rotations. It rotates around the anti-clockwise rotations of 270 degree anti-clockwise rotations. It undergoes the 270 degree anti-clockwise rotations so that the all the small intestine as well as the derivatives of the meat gut, they will located in its own normal anatomical positions. So first of all, see here in the first diagram, it describes that the meat gut, it is attached via the superior mesenteric artery and divides into the pre-arterial segment and the post-arterial segment. Now this pre-arterial segment starts to elongate. Pre-arterial segment starts to elongate it, and because of the small abdominal cavity and the enlarged liver organ, now this meat gut loop, they will herniate. They starts to herniate outside the abdominal cavity in the extra-embryonic cilium, and that condition, that is known as the physiological herniations. And during the herniations of the intestine, it undergoes the 90 degree anti-clockwise rotations. During the herniations of the intestine from the abdominal cavity to the extra-embryonic cilium, it undergoes the 90 degree anti-clockwise rotation. So 90 degree anti-clockwise rotations. So at the 10th week of the intrauterine life, the abdominal cavity is sufficient to lose the intestine or the meat gut loop. Because of that reason, now the pre-arterial segment, as well as the post-arterial segments, they start to herniate inside the abdominal cavity. And at that time, it undergoes 180 degree rotations. It undergoes anti-clockwise rotations around the 180 degree, and the axis for the rotation is the superior mesenteric artery. The axis for the rotations of the meat gut loop is the superior mesenteric artery, because they under, and in total they will undergoes the 270 degree, place the derivatives of the meat gut in its normal position, in its normal positions. And at the sixth week of the intrauterine life, the post arterial segment gives rise a diverticulum called as the sickle bud. The sickle bud gives rise the cecum and the vermiform appendix. Sickle bud forms the cecum and the vermiform appendix. Rotations of the meat gut, it is important. So please read. The axis for the rotations is the superior mesenteric artery, and it undergoes the 270 degree anti-clockwise rotations. Total, there are 270 degree anti-clockwise rotations. First 90 degree anti-clockwise rotations, it will occur when the intestine starts to herniate from the abdominal cavity to the extra-embryonic cilium, and when it re-enters the abdominal cavity, there will be the 180 degree anti-clockwise rotation. In case of the stomach, there is a 90 degree clockwise rotation, but in case of the meat gut, there is a anti-clockwise rotation. post arterial segment. It gives rise to the diverticulum known as the sickle bud. This sickle bud gives rise to the cecum and the vermiform appendix. Axis for the rotations of the meat gut is superior mesenteric artery. So these are the derivatives in the derivatives of the foregut, midgut, and the hindgut. It is in the tabulated form. Part of the floor of the mouth, including the tongue, pharynx, various derivatives of the pharyngeal pouches and the thyroid gland, esophagus, stomach, duodenum, the proximal, the first part of the duodenum, and the upper half of the second part of the duodenum up to the major duodenal papilla. Liver and the extrahepatic biliary system, pancreas, respiratory system, these all are the derivatives of the foregut, meat gut. What are the derivatives of the meat gut? Duodenum, second part of the duodenum distal to the major duodenal papilla, third and the fourth parts of the duodenum, jejunum, ileum, cecum, and the vermiform appendix, ascending colon, and the right two-thirds of the transverse colon. These are the derivatives of the meat gut and the hindgut. So what are the derivatives of the hindgut? Left one-third of the transverse colon, descending sigmoid colon, pelvic colon also, sigmoid colon also known as the pelvic colon. So don't confuse with the pelvic colon. Sigmoid colon also called as the pelvic colon. Rectum, upper part of the anal canal, and parts of the urogenital system derived from the primitive urogenital sinus. These all are the derivatives of the hindgut. And you know the terminal part of the anal canal developed from the proctodium. And the cranial part of the oral cavity, they derive from the stomatodium. So clinical anatomy, omphalocele or the exomphalos. By the 10th week of the intrauterine life, the herniated intestine has to re-enter the abdominal cavity. If it fails to re-enter the abdominal cavity, the condition is called the omphalocele or the exomphalos. Clear? What is omphalocele or the exomphalos? Normally, in the 6th week of the intrauterine life, the meat gut loops, they will herniate outside the abdominal cavity. And by the 10th week of the intrauterine life, it has to re-enter. If it fails to re-enter, then the condition is called the omphalocele. Then what is gastrochisis? Gastrochisis means if the body wall cavity failed to fuse, then the abdominal viscera, it will herniate. That condition is called the gastrochisis. See, omphalocele means it is the herniations of the meat gut loop by the umbilicus. And the gastrochisis means, see, first here this is the meat gut loop. Meat gut loop, it is divided into the pre-arterial segment and the post-arterial segment by the attachment of the superior mesenteric artery. By the attachment of the superior mesenteric artery, the meat gut loop, it is divided into the pre and the post arterial segment. And first of all, this pre arterial segment, it undergoes the elongations. And it starts the coiling. But because of the large liver, because of the enlargement of the liver and the small abdominal cavity, now meat gut loop, they will herniate and lodges within the umbilical cord, fetal umbilical cord, in the extra embryonic cavity. And during the herniations, it undergoes 90 degree anti-clockwise rotations. Because of that reason, the pre-arterial segment and the post-arterial segment, it lies in a horizontal plane. It lies in a same plane. Pre-arterial segment on the right side and the post-arterial segment on the left side. See, primitive gut, these are the tubular structure. it lies in the midline. For this normal position, there is a rotations for the normal anatomical positions. So first of all, there is a 90 degree anticlockwise rotation when it herniates from the abdominal cavity to the extra embryonic cavity. Okay. Now, at the 10th week, by the 10th week, there is a large abdominal cavity to accommodate the intestine. Because of the large abdominal cavity and the liver becomes the livers also, they are reducing its size because of that reason, as well as the differential growth of the body cavities, differential growth of the body wall. Now, this herniated loops starts to re-enter the abdominal cavity, And at that time, this loops undergoes the 180 degree anti-clockwise rotation. 180 degree anti-clockwise rotations. And at the meantime, the post-arterial segment gives rise to one diverticulum. This diverticulum called as the sickle bud. And this sickle bud gives rise to the cecum and the vermiform appendix. And the axis for the rotations of the midgut loop is the superior mesenteric artery. By the rotations around the anticlockwise rotation, now the sickle bud, it will lodge in the right iliac fossa, ascending colon in the right lumbar region, intestine in the umbilical region, that is a small intestine in the umbilical region, and the junctions of the midgut and the hindgut is the right 2/3 of the transverse colon and the left 1/3 of the transverse colon. Right 2/3 of the transverse colon, up to the right 2/3 of the transverse colon, these and proximally they are the derivatives of the midgut, and distal to the right 2/3 of the transverse colon or the left 1/3 of the transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon, rectum, anal canal, all these are the derivatives of the hindgut. And the artery of the hindgut is which artery? Inferior mesenteric artery. Artery of the midgut?
Superior mesenteric.
And the stomach? Foregut?
Trunk.
Celiac trunk. See, important rotations of the midgut loop. You have to draw the diagram. And the stomach. See, at the 4th week of the embryo, the ventral wall of the foregut, it gives rise a diverticulum. This diverticulum is called the respiratory diverticulum. We have studied in the respiratory system. So this respiratory diverticulum enlarges to form the trachea and the lungs. So this ventral is the respiratory diverticulum and the distal dorsal is the foregut. The part which lies dorsal to the respiratory diverticulum, it gives rise the esophagus. This tracheoesophageal septum divides the foregut into the ventral part and the dorsal part. Ventral part, it gives derivatives of the respiratory system. This blue color gives the derivative of the respiratory system. And the posterior part of the foregut, it gives it forms the esophagus. See? And the part of the foregut, which appears as a dilations, it forms the stomach. And stomach undergoes the undergoes the rotations along the longitudinal and the anteroposterior axis. It undergoes the rotations around the longitudinal and the anteroposterior axis. During the longitudinal rotations, it undergoes the 90 degree clockwise rotations. Because of that reason, left surface becomes the antero superior left surface becomes the anterior superior surface, and the right surface becomes the posterior inferior surface. Because of that reason, the nerve supply of the anterior superior surface, it is supplied by the posterior vagal trunk, which is formed by the right vagus nerve, and the posterior inferior surface, it is supplied by the anterior vagal trunk, which is formed by the left vagus nerve. And anterior border of this stomach, it is connected to the anterior body wall, ventral body wall, via the mesogastrium, ventral mesogastrium. And the posterior or the dorsal border, it is connected with the posterior body wall via the dorsal mesogastrium, ventral mesogastrium. Within the ventral mesogastrium, there is the outgrowth of the liver bud, which divides the ventral mesogastrium into the ventral part and the dorsal part. Ventral part gives rise the falciform ligament as well as the coronary ligament. Dorsal part, it gives rise the lesser omentum. And this ventral mesogastrium, it is derived from the septum transversum. See, for the MCQ also important. Biva, in Biva also it is important. And the dorsal mesogastrium, which connects the dorsal border with the posterior abdominal wall, it forms the greater omentum. Greater omentum. So how greater omentum is formed? Via the dorsal mesogastrium. How lesser omentum is formed? It is formed by the dorsal part of the ventral mesogastrium. How falciform ligament is formed? It is formed by the ventral part of the ventral mesogastrium. Ventral mesogastrium is a derivative or the derived from the septum transversum. Any questions? Omphalocele. If the herniated loops fails to re-enter the abdominal cavity by the 10th week of the intrauterine life, that condition is called the omphalocele or the exomphalos. Gastrocisis, failure of the fusion of the body wall cavity, leads to herniation of the abdominal viscera. That condition is called the gastrocisis. You know achalasia cardia, tracheoesophageal fistula, and the lining epithelium of the GIT, they derive from the endoderm. Lining epithelium, whole lining epithelium of the GIT, they derive from the endoderm, except the a part of the oral cavity, which is derived from the stomodium, and a part of the anal canal, which is derived from the proctodium. The lining epithelium is derived from the ectoderm. Except that, all the lining epithelium of the GIT is derived from the endoderm. And submucosa, muscular layer, serosa, these all are derived from the splanchnopleuric layer of the lateral plate of the mesoderm. Splanchnopleuric layer of the lateral plate of the mesoderm.